if this man had not disguised himself, everybody would have known this truth so quick. The Bible made me to understand that the devil will disguise himself like an angel of light. He will come as a wolf in sheep clothing. Very, very innocent. Very, very subtle. But it is until you come very close to them, you know that they are wicked.
Now some news coming out of Nigeria in the last
one of the worst disasters on the African continent in recent memory. Numbers vary.
The death toll has now risen to 80.
What really happened at the Synagogue Church of All Nations?
He was never remorseful or pitiful for these people. He could see a man die and never feel it.
All over the world. Open your lips, share your testimony to those who care to listen.
By this point, Joshua's miracles had gained him an international following, and he was a household name.
I welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ.
He had huge resources, huge amounts of influence, not just in Nigeria, throughout Africa, Israel, Mexico, Singapore.
His reputation globally was enormous. He was a god. He was the deputy Jesus. Everybody wanted to be close to the prophet.
A lot of Dominicans with dreams in their hearts for miracles have gathered here to witness the momentous arrivals of Prophet TV Joshua.
Right from airport, you see convoy, army, police, expat riders in front and back by the side.
His private jet was very fancy. So inside, you know, all the leather interior, and it was very posh, as you would call it.
Moments ago, Prophet TB Joshua landed and was welcomed by the president and the entire cabinet.
TB Joshua was creating an empire of these dignitaries and presidents that could give him credibility.
He would display these world leaders on the stage to show everybody how powerful he was.
Man of God, I want to thank you.
Don't miss a day without watching Emmanuel TV.
This is somebody then in the end who became like a father.
He believed he was more valuable than the president. People should pay to come and see him. They should be prepared to pay their life savings, in essence. And that is what happened.
Would you like to visit the Synagogue Church of All Nations, Lagos, Nigeria?
This foreign visitors would come from all across the world.
It was the greatest tourist attraction for Nigeria.
There was not enough space, and he's somebody who loved money. So he built a guest house.
He would send people and say, go and see what they charge at a five-star hotel in America. Like, I'm worth that. Like, they can't come here and expect God to give them something for nothing.
People were also desperate for healing. They would pay this ridiculous amount.
Money is a good thing, but the love of faith is bad.
We take the balance sheets to him in his office. TB Joshua would stand from his chair and started laughing. Owode, 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 meaning that, money has come.
The guest house was a huge business industry.
There were tour groups going up from South Africa in quite large numbers who came to stay in the compound.
Oh, these are my daughter's photos. And she was growing up.
My daughter's Sibongile princess. It was her first trip to synagogue. She was looking forward to be there as well, just like everybody that you see on TV.
This one, it was a week before she went to synagogue.
She still had her teddy bear in her room. She told her siblings, make sure you take care of them. She was this perfectionist.
My sister, Pumzile, she is the golden child of the family. She was injured. She had a back problem at work. She couldn't get any assistance. Somebody referred her to this church in Nigeria, promising all these miracles or whatever.
Hallelujah! You see the miracles every day on television, and you go like, this can only be the hand of God.
That day I was working in the office. He sent me to go and call someone. I kind of went into the church auditorium and I just felt like this dust in the air. It was really surreal. I just saw this huge plumes of dust.
I was close to his office. One of the disciples, he ran inside and he started saying, the building came down, the building came down.
I remember running towards there and it's just complete chaos. No one really understands what's actually happened.
I saw that the whole building had turned to rubbles that collapsed. I realized that it was the guest house. That was where 99% of the guests he had then were lodged.
It was all silent. You didn't hear cries of people or anything like that. And I guess it's because people were buried so deep.
You're looking at pictures from just a few hours ago. Part of the Synagogue Church of All Nations collapsed. Many are said to be trapped inside.
There were all these news flashes coming in. This church building has fallen, and they don't know the details. The whole family was panicking.
An incident described as one of the worst disasters ever to strike a place of worship.
No fewer than 50 persons are feared killed following the collapse.
The building was believed to be a guest house for foreign members of the TB Joshua Synagogue Church.
I tried to call my daughter, tried to send an SMS. There was no response. Oh no, that's when now I could not breathe.
When we asked for information, they couldn't give us anything. They said, no, I must wait, we must pray. How?
No phone call from synagogue. I couldn't sleep. You know, you're waiting for the next day, you're waiting for the phone call.
Emmanuel TV, God with us.
It was Sunday afternoon. TB Joshua came, it was a life service.
There was all over the world. Let me start from Friday morning. I received a phone call that there was a jet here at the church, hovering around a building, passing over the building four times at a very low rate before the building collapsed. So we are going to show you the video.
Take note of the upper left-hand corner of the screen. A strange aircraft flies over the building at the Synagogue Church of All Nations. 9 minutes later, the strange aircraft returns. This is the moment of the incident.
On television, they were showing us that the building had been bombed. And they were showing us this aircraft.
Don't be scared. You are not the target, I'm the target. I know my hour has not yet come. I have not yet finished my job.
The president's helicopter touched down on the grounds of the synagogue church, waiting to receive him, Prophet TB Joshua.
My personal condolences and that of the federal government to the church, but primarily my coming here is to express a condolence to Prophet Joshua.
I heard from SCOAN after 5 days. They said, we are afraid your daughter did not make it. My daughter died in the place where I thought it's safe.
Because the Bible said, bring your child in the way of the Lord. I made sure that they were always in church. I didn't know that I was taking them to church to be killed. That part I was not expecting.
A delegation from this Nigerian church, they came, they pronounced my sister has passed on. I didn't have a chance to say goodbye to her.
I was in South Africa. That's when Daddy called, and the instruction was I needed to assist in going around to these families within South Africa whose children, husbands, or wives had died at the building to go and give money, bags of money. It was scripted. Your relative that has passed on, they are more privileged than you because they died in the house of the Lord. We would give family cash. There were no transfers, we would give cash. We would tell them they mustn't speak to media, they mustn't give reports or anything. Basically, we were silencing them.
When they came, we asked, why are you giving us money? We were told it's a gift. I said, no, this is not a gift. You are trying to buy our silence.
When we refused taking the money, he started threatening us. That's when he said, no, your daughter won't be happy if I don't take the money.
It's not that you are poor, but it's an obligation. Your daughter will not be happy. I so rest in peace, she will not be happy.
He sent me these messages. It says, if you focus on what you have lost, you might lose everything. Now he's threatening me that my whole family will go down. The same way my daughter went down.
I started searching for information. You start asking questions. What are you hiding? What really happened?
The families were lied to. The aeroplane story is just pure lie. I can tell you the honest truth. On the 12th of September, somebody working in the maintenance department went to that guest house. As he was there, he realized that that building was unstable. It was shaky. By 12:01, the building collapsed. They told us then that don't say what you know. So he knew that there was something wrong with the building, but they were managing it.
There was no plane that dropped bombs. It was structural failure. During the time it was being built, I stood with TB Joshua on that building. He was given instructions to his head of maintenance, and he just kept kind of pushing and saying, I want it higher, it must go higher. The foundations were never built to cater for the height of the building that TB Joshua categorically demanded must be built.
Anything close to Jesus resists attack. I want to assure you that our God will get back to them.
The building collapse is a good example of everyday life under TB Joshua. It's just a series of cover-ups. It's just this one was so big, it was almost impossible for him to make it go away.
TB Joshua blocked the site immediately. He was trying to hide how brutal it was. Even the emergency units, they never allowed them to come in at first. So because of that, there were critical cases where people were trapped. I even witnessed one of the guests that came. He was trapped in the rubble there. It was holding his leg. A church worker like me told the guy that The only option is they are going to cut off his leg. They had to bring this chainsaw. Chopped off the leg. Issues like that was not handled without TB Joshua's awareness. He's the one that gave that instruction.
I just remember all these people coming towards me, and one of them was this man, and somebody was like trying to carry him. His leg was kind of just hanging off, and I think his arm was too.
The next thing I will hear is, Emmanuel, go and take your camera. The man of God needs to see what is happening here. TB Joshua wanted me to film. He prioritized filming over rescuing people. They created a small hole. Then they put in this halogen light. When I entered that hole, my God, horrific scene. You could hear people.
Help me, help me.
And their voices are fainting. You don't know what they are going through, but you are assuming that these people are dying off.
Quite quickly after it happened, we all were designated like our roles, and I was in charge of press. Initially, the press weren't allowed to go in, but after a while, tried to get things organized.
The church was pulling out people, showing to the external media team that they are saving people. Telling them to wait there and say, thank you, Jesus. Then they hit the dead bodies. So when it was 8:30 to 9 p.m., they asked everybody to leave. That was when the real work was done. All the hands, the legs, the heads, scattered bodies. Oh my God.
At night, that was when we were doing the recordings of the dead people as we were putting them into body bags. The body bags were being put in our own church ambulances.
They were stacking bodies. I can't count the bodies that was brought out.
There were bags and bags and bags. And I never knew the final destination.
We got into a bus and there was like this smell. Someone told me that this bus is full of dead bodies. And we're transporting them at night so that the press can't see during the day.
The whole system was just to protect the image of the church and him and TB Joshua.
When this happened, I thought he would come and see the site straight away. He didn't even go. He just stayed in his office. And I was just like, why is he not coming to see this tragedy?
When I left the scene, I have to go and give him my report. He watched those tapes, and I can tell you, I never saw an atom of compassion. He could see a man die and never feel it. That same day, he still met one of those ladies. The same way it has always been. That was like, again.
Over the years, the abuse, the rape was just too much. People tried to speak up to expose him, but nobody would listen. Had people listened, no one would have died.
To live as part of the synagogue community is really difficult. Sometimes cracks begin to appear in your own head. Years and years of lack of sleep, you're so exhausted. I had a tap when I was in bed asleep. Daddy's calling you. And my heart sank. I walked up the stairs and I remember thinking, no, 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 no. He ushered for me to take all my clothes off. And he was angry and it was forceful. The most horrendous, terrifying experience I have ever, ever been through. I remember walking down the stairs crying. I thought, I have to talk to somebody. And I said to one female disciple, from a human point of view, the relationship I have with Daddy is wrong. And she immediately bent forward and buried her head in her hands and said, I know what you're talking about. He does it to me too. And I was, oh my goodness. And I remembered all those young girls going up and downstairs. I'm not the only one. We're not the only ones. It was like I had a blindfold on. And in that one moment, suddenly, I was like, whoa, he's not a holy man. The way he hits people, the way he shouts at people, the way we don't have any sleep, the reporting. I was petrified because at this point I knew exactly what I was a part of. I realized I've got to escape.
There is no fence to sit on. There's no in between. You're in or you're out. And that was partly why it was such a huge big deal to leave, to escape.
You have to make a choice. There's no neutral kingdom.
If you left, you were leaving salvation. You were going to die and go to hell. And you really believed this. This was terrifying.
Fear was physical. I was shaking. If I could have, I would have ran through that airport. I was doing the unthinkable. I was doing a sin. When I saw the green fields of the UK, I thought, I've done it. I can't believe this has happened. I had to tell TB Joshua I wasn't coming back because if I didn't, they would come after me. I said, Daddy, I believe the relationship I have with you is wrong and I'm never coming back. And for those few seconds before I put the phone down, I heard panic in his voice.
I received a phone call. I was asked if I knew anything about Annika leaving and I said, no, I didn't. Tivrosha said, she left because she says that I was lying on top of her. It just made me think, oh my gosh, I didn't think that that was happening to her. He had said, that sort of thing only happens to me. So Joshua started crying and saying, you know, I've said whatever I do to you is just for your salvation. I've not done this to anybody else. Whatever Annika is saying is not true. The next thing I know, I'm called in and some disciples' parents are there. And he said, you need to tell them that what she is saying isn't true. I remember that meeting because I had to lie, yet knowing what happened to me.
It's just horrible how you go through so much pain and then you cover for the person that is causing this.
Emmanuel, thank you for joining us here.
I was very good at looking happy, but I was dead for a long time inside. I decided I'm out. I can't take this at all. When I left, I went back to confront him because I wanted abuse to stop.
Make me come here and meet. I
was filming this on my phone in case something bad happened. We'd obviously seen the security manhandle people before.
Let me get out. Let me get out. Don't hold me. Why can't he come here? What? Is it so holy? He cannot come here. When he has sex with me? Let him come here!
There was just a panic out of nowhere that just grew. in the office. TB Joshua didn't see it coming. He didn't expect Angie, you know, of all people, to confront him. So that day felt like his whole life was coming to an end. Everything that he had worked hard for was coming to an end.
And the taxi driver said, okay, look, I can't drive fast. They're going to shoot my tires out.
I'd seen police on the gates beat people, beat disciples, beat followers. When we're working for Nigerian State, they were working for TB Joshua, who paid them huge sums of money.
Two security guards there, they held me, but I just wrestled my way free. There happened to be an Okada that came past, and I just hopped on, and we just said, go to the airport. You're in and out of traffic, right side of the road, wrong side of the road. To just get on that plane. When we left, we wrote a letter that we sent to the church, itemizing the serious abuses that people were having to endure just being a disciple. The church knew, they didn't investigate, they did absolutely nothing.
When I left, I told this police officer everything. And she said, because this happened in another country, all we can do is take your story, give it to Interpol. But I never heard anything. I watched that place like a hawk. All those brothers and sisters that I'd made, I knew they were trapped there, in their mind, and physically trapped there.
Now, as Christians, our life is not our own.
Years and years I watched to see who would come out, who was the next person to leave.
Write it, there will be betrayer among my workers. But greater is he that is in me.
I was there almost 14 years of my life. All these beatings, sexual abuse, it was too much. I was traumatized because what I witnessed, I couldn't live with it.
I had the kind of guilty conscience of what we did there. When I left, I wrote a 13-page petition against him to the police. They couldn't do anything.
TB Joshua said, if people leave, they will die. All right, before I die, let me tell the whole world.
We teamed up and did that video. I wanted people to know the truth.
All true believers need to be aware of the man TB Joshua.
It was a concentration camp. People were being tortured, suffering and smiling.
After Bisola left, TB Joshua said she was being a betrayer against the ministry, saying lots of lies. He spoke about that usually he lets God speak for him, but this time he has to defend himself.
I was called to go and run a voiceover. I was given a script to read targeting Bisola Johnson. She was a liar. We have to make her look like a complete nutcase. We have to discredit her. He'd clearly taken footage of times she had been forced to confess things.
What is the problem you have with your brain?
I always have a terrible headache, and anytime it happens, I always misbehave. I always behave irrationally.
Is this the behavior of somebody in their right mind? Is this the kind of person who we should believe?
Bisola was disgraced and humiliated. Paul Agomor, yeah, he did the same thing.
Would you put your trust in a man like this?
This thing went all over YouTube. It's still there today. It was sent all around the world. That was a warning to everybody. If you leave, if you speak about the things you've seen and heard, and we all held secrets individually, that this could be you.
Oh, God, please. Oh, please help me.
It was all about silencing opposition.
Well, to go with the TV, Joshua. Fija for our to bat TV, Joshua. There's a patamu, Katie, the devil on our TV, Joshua. When Sister Bisola and the Prophet Agomo, when they left, TV Joshua came to the mountain, said they are now rebelled against us. TV Joshua said I should curse them. Sister Bisola picture, Agomo picture, insert it inside that tree. The assignment given to me is for them to die. He didn't tell us the meaning. Either it's God or it's juju. But I know God is forgiving God.
Life was turning around against me. I left my house around 10 o'clock in the morning. This when I saw these three men. They beat me blue-black.
I'm not a Muslim, but I have to put on hijab in order to cover my identity. TB Joshua continues sending different people to threaten my life.
I ran from Lagos to Abuja, from Abuja to Cotonou, from Cotonou to Ghana.
This is terrible.
Everywhere I turned to was like war.
Joshua came after me. He sent people. I was driving. They shot at the back of the vehicle. Bah, 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 bah. He sent them to kill me. He knew I knew so much about him. All the secret things he do, the manipulations.
It is time for healing. In the name of Jesus Christ, be healed. In Jesus' name.
The miracles he did, the whole thing is stage managed and faked. It's faked.
You are healed.
I supervise everything for years. I know everything that happens.
Come out if you're suffering from cancer of any part of the body. Body poison.
It's a complicated system. We have the emergency section.
Is the emergency section of the Synagogue Church of All Nations.
They have been trained by medical doctors. Any cancerous situation, they send them away. Then, people that had ordinary wounds that can heal, will bring them in to present as cancer.
By his wounds, she is healed.
Those people are being fed medication. They give them drugs to get, you know, speedy recovery. What you just see is the before and the finality. I know because I was synagogue chief video editor.
You think that that thing just happened the same day. Some of them took span of 1 year, 6 months.
With her wound healed after just a few days, why should anyone question so much evidence?
The emergency department were responsible for making miracles look real. They would be the ones responsible for writing and approving the placards.
The names of their ailments are written boldly on their placards.
Someone would come and say, I've got a headache, and it would be written down as some other exaggerated condition.
Some people who say, I'm having pains in my leg and waist, we are telling him that, look, if you come out there and walk with your leg, Papa will not pray for you. You must shout, man of God, help me. Man of God, help me. I cannot walk.
Man of God, help me. I have difficulty in walking. Man of God, help me.
I cannot walk. Man of God, help me. Man of God, help me.
The people themselves are clearly being manipulated. They would be told, exaggerate their problems so that God can heal you, and exaggerate your healing so that God could perfect your healing.
To God be the glory.
Thank you, Jesus, you're my God.
To be candid, I've never seen any crippled person that was healed in Synagogue Church. T.B. Joshua was the one who masterminded the manipulation from the beginning to the end.
It's very difficult when you begin to dissect the fact that these miracles were staged, because then you have to start understanding that people died who didn't have to.
Dr. Trish, go ahead.
T.B. Joshua advised people, after praying for them, not to take their drugs.
If you cannot trust in God with your medicine, you cannot trust in God without your medicine.
People stop taking their medication, they stop taking their pills.
I want to throw this away. So wait till that baby.
They were dying in their droves. So many of them.
I know people died because they didn't take their medicine. And it's difficult to live with that.
Some people will ask, you know all this. Why were you still there? It's difficult to explain. T.B. Joshua told me, don't worry. We use this thing to build people's faith in Christ. I wasn't having in mind that I was actually doing something wrong. I thought I was doing something that will help to build the faith of people in the church.
This miracle has gone a long way to build your faith and restore the agony that he was going through.
I think everybody that came from that place has guilt. What's so desperately painful and sad is we thought we were doing the right thing.
Rejoicing right now, for the Lord God Almighty has set them free from the...
It's difficult for me to put my hands on the number of people that lost their lives. He has a lot of blood in his hands. The death of people doesn't mean anything to him.
Today marks exactly a year since the church guesthouse collapsed. 116 people, including 85 South Africans, were killed.
T.B. Joshua had claimed his building was destroyed by a terror strike, but the coroner has ruled the building wasn't built properly.
Families suffered a huge injustice because it came out later that actually floors were added without permission, so it was obviously a structural error.
The coroner found that T.B. Joshua must be criminally liable for whatever happened there. He kept on skipping court. The whole case was postponed over and over again. It's like he's been protected by who, I don't know.
Politicians were coming visiting him. He was giving them money. He would give me money. Me personally, he would say, drop it in this person's car. There was a time, he signed $9,000. He bought the whole system.
Never even set his foot in court to come and answer for what happened. No one has been arrested. All we hear is lies and more lies.
My daughter was buried alive and helpless. The pain is too much. I'm still waiting for justice.
We can't get over it because we have no closure. It's like a huge black albatross hanging around us. This pain, we are going to take it to our graves.
I do tell God that I miss my daughter today. I know she's smiling in heaven now. In a diary, you know, she wrote, for her wedding, these are the wedding song and all that, yeah. I miss her.
That blood that was spilled there is crying for justice. But to T.B. Joshua, it's business as usual.
the stadium say, I love Jesus.
Te amo, Jesus.
Every knee shall bow.
Less than a year after the building collapse, Joshua was back on the world stage. It was as if the building collapse had never even happened.
What matters to him was his reputation. Everything was just for camera footage, to please crowd, to raise his name high. And he's ready to sacrifice anyone just to keep that name, even his own daughter.
My existence as a child from another mother undermined everything he claimed to stand for.
He felt threatened by the fact that I had the boldness to confront him.
He locked her in a room for months. She was treated like a prisoner.
Every day, the beatings were not ceasing. Eventually, this disciple escorted me to the front of the church gate and then just left me there. I found myself homeless.
The securities of the church, he has given them instruction, this girl should never come close to the gate. He doesn't want to even hear that she existed.
I had nobody to reach out to. No one would believe me. Nothing prepared me for that life.
She was sent on the street as a beggar. And her dad is a multimillionaire. And this is the same person that will come out on TV doing charity, giving people bag of rice. You know how it is to survive in the street of Lagos. It was as good as she was given a death sentence. He never loved people. He never cared for people. He was just an opportunist feeding on vulnerable young people.
And then, the exact moment that Prophet TB Joshua touched the photograph, we saw a wonderful example of God's power on the thing.
I had worked for him for years. I've sacrificed my life for this man, and yet, still, I was not free from the problem that I'd gone there with, which was that I was gay. All the blame was placed on me. It was my lack of faith. He used to say that isolation was the best way to receive Jesus. I spent 2 years in the compound, isolated. I wasn't in a room. But no one was allowed to speak to me. There were like buildings that were under construction. And I used to go there and smash my head against the wall. I had a complete mental breakdown and I tried to commit suicide. He knew how I felt, but he didn't care. I began to realize that he wasn't who he said he was. That was when I was able to face myself for the first time at 33 years old and look in the mirror and say, you're gay, accept it, deal with it yourself, this man can't help you. When I eventually got out, I started looking for people who over those 12, 13 years I had been with there. And I just went like down this rabbit hole of like one horror to another horror. People who were repeatedly raped, people who'd had abortions, some Nigerian, some Ghanaian, some South African, some Dutch, some from the UK, like some from the States. They're all coming back and saying, Ray, didn't you know? You know, you must have known. I'm like, I didn't know. Like, why am I going to stay there if I know this is happening to all these people? And it was just, it was horrifying. You've got this man who positioned himself as a father with many children and went on to rape, molest, and abuse all these people who held that bond sacred and called him daddy. How is somebody like that permitted to walk free?
Founder of the Synagogue Church of All Nations, TB Joshua, has died. He was 57 years old.
This is a big shock to millions of people around the world and, of course, many people in Nigeria who were directly following TB Joshua.
There was no indication that the preacher was ill before his death that has shocked his followers. TB Joshua was the leader and founder.
He was a god, like you never thought he would die. Gosh, that is why people went crazy.
Just live us like this.
I cried when he died. I cried for an apology that I will never receive.
The Nigerian Senate has held a minute silence. The lawmakers eulogized Prophet TB Joshua, saying he epitomized.
He is probably one of the greatest con men to ever exist, to con so many millions of people into believing that you are holy.
He goes into glory where there's no more conflict, where there's no more strife.
The bad guy won, and very powerful men propped him up. He had to have his enablers in the police service, in the government, different politicians in different countries. Nothing could bring him down.
I want to tell my story to say that, look, it's not easy, but you'll be okay. You can come out of this and you can heal and you can find life again after.
What kept me quiet was fear. And fear is an illusion. I'm proud of myself for having the courage to tell the truth about who this man really was.
He's my son. He's my daughter.
The fact that I have two kids is a miracle because of the trauma I experienced.
It's not been easy, but despite all the crying and being upset and being upset about friends and family still there, I'm so grateful to be out. I'm so grateful just to be free.
I go through my days where I'm at my lowest point, and honestly, I just want more peace, like tranquility, stability. I lost everything, my home, my family, but for me, it comes down to the truth. And for as long as there is breath in me, I'll defend that until the very end.
Good morning, viewers all over the world. Good morning, church. It is a new dawn.